أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله والحمد حقه كما يستحقه حمدا كثيرا. وأعوذ به من شر نفسي، إن النفس لأمارة بالسوء إلا ما رحم ربي. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، خاتم النبيين، سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا، أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين، واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين، من أول يوم ظلمهم إلى قيام يوم الدين. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله، وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت، وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا، ورحمة الله وبركاته.
اللهم صل على محمد.
قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وإن عزموا الطلاق فإن الله سميع عليم. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. For the purification of the souls and the enlightenment of the hearts and for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior, أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. Enlighten your souls and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Respected elders, brothers and sisters, salamun alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's a dreaded D word that many married and non-married individuals fear. It brings about much stress, much anxiety, much suffering and pain. It is experienced by millions of people across the world. Divorce, or the termination of marriage, is a phenomena that affects many individuals, irrespective of their background, of their denomination, or their ethnicity. We find that in many countries there are processes that facilitate divorce. It's an option when marriages do not work. You find that many a times it's a very costly process. Legally, it may take a long time. At the same time, those who go through divorce will undoubtedly suffer in many shapes and forms. They will also suffer psychologically, socially. Many people involved will not never be the same. At the same time, we find there are people who have come forward and divorced in the most unusual of circumstances. Because we know today, when a divorce takes place, there is normally a legal process. Sometimes courts are involved. In other occasions, it is what? A religious procedure. Yet in some environments, in the most bizarre of cases, divorces happened. Like whom? Like a man by the name of Ahmed. He is from the area of West Bengal. In 2006, this individual, he was asleep next to his wife. It happens sometimes that people speak during their sleep. So during his sleep, he said three times, "You are divorced," in Arabic. "Anti talaq," three times in his sleep. His wife woke up. She heard that he had said this, ignored it. Later, they went to a scholar in that particular area and said, "This is what happened." The scholar said that you are now divorced. You cannot be what together anymore. You are now what? Single people. At the same time, I recall reading that a Saudi man once saw his wife flirt with whom? With an individual in the shopping mall, a shopkeeper. He was so angry. What did he do? He went and said to an individual who is in charge of the public speaker system, "I want to speak." So he took the public speaker system and said, "I am divorcing my wife," three times before everyone else. These and many others constitute interesting areas in which people develop what? Develop divorce. Of course, statistically, many are of the opinion that the rates of divorce are increasing in many communities and societies. In the United States, rates are estimated to be around 45% of marriages ending in divorce. In the United Kingdom, they're about 42%. In 2011, official statistics state in the United Kingdom, there were 235,000 divorce cases. It is not something to be taken for granted. It indeed affects so many individuals. When we look at the religion of Islam, this is not a subject that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ignored. Indeed, the teachings of the religion espouse a strong relationship between the husband and wife, that the institution of marriage is the most beloved institution in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something that is emphasized in the teachings of the Holy Quran and the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam. You find that this notion of the husband and the wife coming together in this unit known as a family is emphasized to be holy, emphasized to be sacred. You and I, as individuals, as the servants of God, must do our utmost to preserve the sanctity of this unit. This unit that today is under attack in many parts around the world. Even the definition of a family today is ambiguous. Many people aren't able to define what a family means. Is it two men living together? Is it two women living together? Is it a woman living with the children? Is it a man or a woman? There are many interpretations of what a family in reality is, yes? Yet at the same time, we find Islam coming forward and saying that marriage and keeping a marriage healthy is that which indeed brings the blessings and the barakah and the mercy and the happiness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are so many examples in history of successful marriages. Marriages that set the role model. Marriages that are exemplary for people to look at and take lessons and apply in their lives. Marriages such as the marriage of Khadijatul Kubra to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Examples like the marriage of the commander of the faithful, Amir al-Mu'mineen, and Sayyidatul Nisa, the lady of light, Fatimatul Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhima. And many others. Yet Islam also recognizes that sometimes marriages don't work. How? That when it comes to breakdown in marital relationship, much effort has been put. There has been an effort to reconcile. People have tried to resolve their differences, but they've come to a stumbling block. Therefore, divorce is presented as an option. An option that is disliked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the narrations from the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam mention, أَبْغَضُ الْحَلَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ الطَّلَاقِ. The most detested element or thing which is permissible in the eyes of God is actually divorce. In fact, the narrations tell us that the Ahlul Bayt point that divorce shakes the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, it is a cause for what? Disruption and a cause for disjoining of the family unit. Today, we are told in statistics as well as studies the impact of divorce upon many people. They say there are three main elements that impact human beings when they go through divorce. The first is psychological, how people go through depression, sadness, unhappiness, anxiety. Many may go through stages where they lose their work. Many may seclude themselves from society. There are psychological impacts when they go through divorce. The second element is what? Social. That you'll find people labeling a divorcee. Sometimes there is a taboo, yes, especially when our sisters divorce. In other words, their impression. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The impression that certain individuals give to the divorcee is what? Is that they may never marry again. Why? Because they have a negative picture of what marriage is all about. They've gone through marriage and they are now in the position to speak about marriage to people. And of course, their experience leaves a lot to be desired. There are social impacts which involve a taboo on those who divorce. But arguably, one of the most devastating impacts of divorce is what? Is the impact on children. That today people speak about, studies indicate how children suffer when their mother and their father separate and go through the stages of divorce. We are told not only is the impact psychological, there's a lot of anxiety, there's a lot of sadness, but at the same time, studies have shown that the children of divorcees are more likely to go through marital problems and divorce themselves. So it has a long-term impact. It is also shown in studies today that they will underachieve in their education. They will also go through what? Substance misuse. They will what? Barricade themselves away from society. All this and more is found when it comes to what? When it comes to the impact and the way divorce, talaq, has upon individuals in society. The religion of Islam discusses talaq. In Sharia law, we find the subject of talaq taught where? In the seminaries. It is found in the books of jurisprudence in under the bab of talaq. Why? Because the Quran mentions talaq and discusses talaq, namely in three areas, in three places. Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, Surah Al-Nisa, chapter 4, and of course Surah Al-Talaq, chapter 65. In these three chapters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discusses talaq. But interestingly, for the individual who studies the Quran objectively, and as the Quran invites us to reflect and contemplate, one realization emerges with regards to talaq in the Holy Quran. And that is, many of the verses are concerning the laws of talaq, the laws of divorce. In other words, you'll find in chapter 65, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how an individual should approach this particular process that, as we mentioned, is disliked by the Almighty. But when they reach a particular stumbling block, then it is an option, despite the fact that it is not encouraged. What should they be thinking about? We should understand that as far as Sharia law, and specifically the teachings of the school of Ahl al-Bayt, talaq has been made, according to Sharia law, something difficult in order to discourage people from doing it. Yes, because I remember I took part in a television program a few months ago with a respected scholar who I have a lot of admiration and respect for, from our brothers, the Ahl al-Sunnah. We did a joint program in a British television channel. We did a program about some of the rules pertaining to Islamic Sharia law. When there was a question about divorce, I came forward and I explained the position of the school of Ahl al-Bayt, that the school of Ahl al-Bayt states, in order for a divorce to be what? Valid, one of the shurut, one of the conditions, is that there must be two just male witnesses. They must be present there. That particular scholar was very much astonished. He said, really? Is that what it needs in your teachings, in your school? I said, yes. He admittedly said, this makes a lot of sense. He said this would prevent talaq being taken for granted and performed very easily. Because we are told one day, and this is a true story, a man was told at the time of Harun al-Abbasi. I say this nearly every year. I am uncomfortable with calling Harun Rashid. Because Bani al-Abbas, they wanted to give names to their khulafa to praise them. They would say that, for instance, a man is al-mu'tasim billah. Yes, al-mutawakkil billah. Harun al-Rashid means Harun the upright. Harun was not upright. Harun was the man who killed the seventh holy imam. Harun was a wretched individual. Therefore, a better title for him is Harun al-Abbasi. We are told at the time of Harun al-Abbasi, a man came before him and said, I, in one particular setting, divorced five women. People said, how? Five women? You're only supposed to marry four. How is it that you divorced five? He said, I went home. I had just recently got married. Therefore, I looked at this first wife of mine that I recently got married to, and I saw that she hadn't prepared any meals. I was angry with her. I said, you are taliq, or divorced. At that moment, there was my second wife next door in the room adjacent. She came out. She said, this wife of yours has just got married to you. It's really unfair that you treat her this way. I looked at her and says, you're also divorced. The third person came out and said, I have never seen someone who deals with their wives in such a way. You have just divorced two of your wives within a minute. He looked at her and says, get what? You're also divorced. The fourth one came out and said, you know what? Although I disagree with all that you have said, I'm not going to criticize you. He looked at her and said, you're also divorced. But at the moment, there was a lady, a servant who had married someone who is what, next door. She shouted, you are the most unjust person, divorcing four of your wives all together at the same time. He said, you are also divorced if your husband agrees. The husband was there, he said, I agree. Therefore, the fifth one was divorced. In other words, what? Anger at that moment causes what? Causes people to act in unsensible ways, not rational, not logical. The school of Ahlul Bayt says and comes forward and says that when it comes to talaq, there must be shurut, there must be rules that must be fulfilled. Like what, for instance? Like there must be the bulugh, that they must have reached what? The age in which there is taklif, a shar'i. There must be what? Intention. They must have the what? They must be sane. They must want the talaq, not by accident. They must not have been coerced. Likewise, the school of Ahlul Bayt says what? It comes forward and says that the woman, as an example, should not be in her menstrual cycle. The husband must not have had a physical relationship in that particular cycle. It talks about the different ways that you and I should understand talaq. How? That the Quran in chapter 65, how many of us know this? We need to know this. Why? So that we are appreciating Islamic law and what the Quran says. Because the Quran says there is a type of talaq known as what? Talaq al-raj'i. Raj'i means what? Majority of talaqs fall under this category, in which if the marriage has been consummated, then when the talaq is recited, and of course Sharia says there is what? A particular pronunciation of talaq. The word talaq must be said in the presence of two just adults who are male. Yes? But the talaq of raj'i is what? The Quran says when a man divorces his wife, she should stay with him in the house during the iddah, during the period of time, yes, in which it has been specified as what? As three cycles in the life of the female, three of her menstrual cycles, if their marriage has been consummated. We are told that this talaq al-raj'i means what? The wife should stay in the house. The Ahlul Bayt have said when she stays in the house, despite the fact that talaq has happened, the husband should see her beautifying herself. She should always be in the state that she is what? Attracting her husband. And the moment the husband touches her, just touches her, out of compassion, the talaq is gone. It's revoked. They're back married again. Can you imagine? All to encourage marriage and the strengthening of the family unit. That is talaq al-raj'i. There is of course talaq which is ba'in. That's another category which involves women who they have not consummated the marriage. And there is a form within this particular category which is what the talaq al-khul'i, which gives the woman the opportunity to ask for talaq from her husband, provided she forsakes her dowry. All this falls and much more, and this is a summary, and much more under the category of the description of talaq when it comes to what? When it comes to the Quran and the teachings of the glorious family of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is all well and good for us to know, but what we wish to discuss and analyze in detail is the pathology of divorce. Why does divorce happen? Because when you and I, if we are married or even if we're not, if we understand the most common reasons why divorce happen, we can work and seek to make sure that we prevent and what put measures in order for the divorce not to be fulfilled, in order for the divorce, God forbid, not to occur. Because what are we told? We are told that today, when it comes to the causes, the pathology of divorce, there are all kinds of causes being put out there. Yes, some of them are strange. Some of them are weird. Yes, today, if you research, you'll find that the Metro newspaper in the United Kingdom, it's delivered, it's given free to people on the underground. It reported that a Japanese woman filed for divorce from her husband. Why? Because her husband does not like the Disney movie Frozen. It's true. She said to him, what kind of a human being are you that you don't like Frozen? Therefore, what happened? She let him go. MashaAllah, many have watched this particular movie. Yes? Likewise, what do we find? We find another example that a Saudi woman filed for divorce where? She filed for divorce in that country because she called her husband. What happened? She found that his phone was at home. She was looking until she found. She picked up his phone and she saw that he had saved her number as Guantanamo. She then went and filed and said, why are you calling me or saving my number as Guantanamo? He argued that it's so that people do not know that you are calling me. But of course, it was a lame excuse. The divorce happened. Yet irrespective of that, what do we find? We find today studies after study have presented the reasons and the causes of talaq. Why does talaq happen in society? I would like to ask for your patience. As I go through 10 reasons, and some we discuss more in detail than others, but these 10 reasons or the pathology of divorce, I would like to humbly ask those who are married, especially, as well as those who are not married at the second level, to make note of these 10. To try and understand, because the religion of Islam is a religion that focuses on prevention, not the cure. Yes, prevention more the cure. Yes, the cure is there. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تقربوا الزنا. Don't even think about fornication. In other words, when you and I seek to protect our family unit, when we look at why divorce is happening in societies such as this, and in the Middle East, and in India, Pakistan, and other countries, we begin to develop what? We begin to develop an understanding of what is it that you and I should stay away from. The number one cause for divorce in certain areas around the world, and number two in other parts, is domestic violence. The use of force and physical injury by both the husband and the wife. Yes, it is not confined only to one particular gender. Because I remember one particular man said that he came to the mosque, someone looked at him and said, what's happened to your face? Your face is bruised. He said, my wife gave me a flower. Why? How could she give you a flower? And this causes, he said, she did not only give me the flower, she gave me the vase that's in it. Yes, the flower that's in it. In other words, she threw it at me. Sometimes there is what? It happens on both sides. The idea of physical abuse. domestic violence is the cause that we are told that brings many into what? The decision, the reason that many come to the decision of divorce. 40%, we are told, approximately, of divorce cases in many parts of the world are due to what? Due to domestic violence. Now, let me ask you a question. As a Muslim community, as the followers of Ahlul Bayt, many ask the question, why do men hit their wives primarily and other way round to a lesser extent? Why does it happen? Number one, sometimes it's to do with the culture. Number two, it's to do with what? With the tendency that people have developed after noticing that this happens where? In other households. Or they have seen it occur within their own parental setup. In other words, when they were young, they saw their father abuse their mother physically. There was domestic abuse fulfilled during their childhood. So they understood or learned that it's normal for people to strike or to hit their wives. Number three, that sometimes some of our brothers have memorized certain verses of the Quran, and some of our brothers have memorized perhaps one of the verses, which is Surah An-Nisa, verse number 34. They come forward and they say, this particular verse gives us the green light to strike our wives. Let's look at this particular verse in detail. Of course, it's not only this verse, because some of our brothers from other schools, they cite a hadith, such as the one that is narrated in Imam al-Bukhari Sahih, in which the wife of the Prophet Aisha says, the Prophet used to hit me by squeezing my chest. In other words, some people utilize some of these particular narrations, yes? Likewise, in tabaqat of whom? In the tabaqat of Ibn Sa'd, we are told that one day, in this famous book that is followed by many Muslims today, we are told that the companions were outside the house of the Holy Prophet. They waited for Rasulullah to emerge, to come out, but he didn't come out. So what did they do? They left. The only person who stayed was the second Khalifa. He went inside, he saw the Prophet upset. He said to him, Ya Rasulullah, why are you upset? He said, well, it's affairs to do with my wives. They are asking me things that I am unable to fulfill. He said, Ya Rasulullah, let me tell you with what I do with my wife. My wife, Safiya bint Thabit, sakaktuha sakka. I slapped her so strong on her cheeks to the extent that she fell onto the ground. Beat them, strike them. So what happens? These and many of similar ahadith are used to justify domestic violence when it comes to the household. How do we respond? What is this verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in Surah An-Nisa? This verse is in reference to the concept of nushuz. It requires your attention. Slightly technical, but we need to have knowledge of the Holy Quran, because we, as the followers of Ahlul Bayt, should be the most versed, well-versed individuals when it comes to the Holy Quran. Why? Because we have the glorious family of the Prophet who interpret the Quran and are the only ones who have the knowledge of the Quran. We should be in that position, yes? So the Quran comes forward and says, وَاللَّاتِي تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنْ. What's nushuz? Nushuz is in reference to the disobedience of a wife to fulfill her responsibilities to her husband, namely sexual responsibilities, the intimacy, yes? Some of the ulama say also if she leaves the house without the permission of the husband, because that's his right. In other words, the wife cannot leave the house without the permission of the husband, unless he's given her normally the permission, and in some instances he asks her not to. But mostly nushuz is when she refuses to take part in the intimacy between the husband and the wife. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there are three stages to deal with this. When people find that their wives are not responding, not because of a what, medical reason or a religious reason. Just simply, they just don't want to have this particular relationship. Allah says, فَعِذُوهُنْ. Speak to them kindly. Advise them. One of the ulama says, this means what? Put happiness in their hearts. Change the mood, yes? The Prophet of Islam, Rasul al-A'zam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, I am surprised by a man who strikes and beats his wife, yet wants to what? wants to sleep with her at night. It's very difficult not to what? To understand the psychology that goes by it. We are told in the Quran, فَعِظُوهُن, speak to them. Words, kindness. Yes? وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ. The second level is, turn the other side in bed, which shows your displeasure. Or some of the ulama have said, separate, go from one bed to another bed. Don't necessarily sleep in one bed. That's the second stage. If these two don't work, then the Quran says, وَضْرِبُوهُن. Now, number one, people have used this verse, those who are Islamophobes, those who wish to distort the message of the religion of Islam, they have said this is the wife-beating verse. Wrong. Yes, this is not the wife-beating verse. Why? Because beating denotes something which is continuous. As we will see now, there are interpretations that have been presented from the school of Ahl al-Bayt as to what وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ means. The first thing that we have to understand is the narration from the Holy Fifth Imam, Imam Muhammad ibn al-Baqir, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. That is with reference to the fact that if you are to display this particular sentiment, and it is what? It is to show that the husband is unhappy, you should use a miswak. What's a miswak? It's the small piece of stick that you used to use for cleaning of the teeth. Tell me, when you pick up a miswak and you hit someone with it, does it hurt? But it's more symbolic to say that what? You are not happy. Number one, ulama say, number two, it must not injure the wife, must not leave a mark, must not cause any bleeding or bruises. Otherwise, what? There is a penalty to pay. Number three, some of the ulama have said, it is only permissible, this light striking, light, only permissible if the wife's nushuz leads to adultery. Or the wife, God forbid, is committing adultery. Number four, ulama come forward and say what? They say that this particular action, what? Sometimes it is better, according to some of the ulama, I saw this ruling, it is better to divorce than to use any force whatsoever against the wife. Yes, some of the ulama say. Yet other interpreters, other commentators from the school of Ahl al-Bayt have come forward and said this وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ does not involve any physical use of force at all. It's not even the miswak, this small tapping. It is what? It is what the Quran says, that when it comes to dharb, it is what? Leaving a place and going to another. Because the Quran says, uses the word dharb in reference to traveling. Therefore, they say this is in reference to the idea, and this is one interpretation, of course, that is not necessarily adopted by many of our fuqaha, but some have come forward recently, that the Quran says, وَإِذَا ضَرَبْتُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. When you travel on the earth, uses the word dharabtum, it means that you leave her. In other words, go somewhere else. In other words, separate as the last measure if there is what? No response. And of course, there should be no striking on the face or on the vulnerable areas. We are told that there are strong narrations and what direction from the Ahl al-Bayt to those who use force and at the same time injure and at the same time practice domestic violence against their wives. The Prophet of Islam says, he who slaps his wife, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment commands the one of the angels of hell to slap him 70 times in Jahannam. Yes, that's definitely found there. At the same time, what are we told? We are told of the need to display kindness, to display mercy, to inculcate in our hearts love and compassion in a marital relationship. In which way? That the Prophet of Islam would sit on the minbar in Madinatul Munawwara, in Masjid al-Nabawi, and would say, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best amongst you is the one who is the best with his family. وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. Yes, and I am the best when it comes to their family. We are told Sa'd ibn Ma'ad, this companion of the Holy Prophet. Most of us have heard of his story in which the Prophet of Islam would say to the companions, there are rows of malaika taking part in the funeral of Sa'd. His mother would say, oh Sa'd, you are indeed blessed that the Prophet has praised you in this way. Definitely you are in Jannah, in Alamul Barzakh. The Prophet said, no, he is being punished because what? He was unfair and what? At the same time, disrespectful to his family. That has a role. That is an element that we, as followers of the Ahl al-Bayt, must understand. Tell me, the hands that strike the chest in the love of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn should not ever strike the wife. Yes, the feet that comes to the majalis of Aba Abdullah should never be what used to inflict injury, pain or suffering against anyone, let alone whom? The wife. This is of the greatest of importance in ensuring that what? That these problems do not occur in society. The second cause that has been discussed is not necessarily physical abuse, but psychological abuse. How do we understand this? Psychologists today, they say there are different types of psychological abuse that both the husband and the wife practice or perform when it comes to marital relationships. They say there is one type which involves the inability to deal with conflicts, inability to solve problems, and when the human being is unable to see the solutions, their stress levels rises, therefore they react by what? Intimidation, by mockery, by abuse, which is most of the time verbal. Yes, it happens both from the husband and the wife. They say this is one type. The other is when it comes from the urgency and the need to show power and what? Domination in the family setup. And it's practiced more by men than women, this other type of psychological abuse. They say there are signs to note if an individual wants to see that they are at the receiving end of psychological abuse. Like what? Like, for instance, humiliation, like the threat to beat, like, for instance, belittling of the action, like, for instance, the threat to not show intimacy or affection, like, for example, criticism, especially before others, shouting, using language which brings sadness. All this is what is a part of this cycle that sometimes certain individuals get away with in the household. The school of Ahl al-Bayt has denounced this categorically. In which way? Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. In many narrations we find the respect that must be given to the wife. Remember this, Amir al-Mu'mineen says, treat your wife like a flower. Notice, what do you do with a flower normally? Yes? Do you grab the flower and tear it apart? Do you use force against the flower? It means treat it with gentle approach. Our fifth Imam, Imam Muhammad ibn al-Baqir, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Speaks about the need to respect the wife and said, the wife is a source of happiness for you. Do not disrespect her. But note, the Prophet of Islam says, the more an individual has an iman, the more he values and respects his wife. Notice this. If you forget everything else that has been mentioned, understand what? That's why, understand this hadith. That's why in our narrations, the Prophet of Islam never used any force or used any violence against his wives. In fact, in the Sunan of Ibn Majah, it is mentioned in one of the books of hadith of our brothers, it is mentioned that the Prophet never beated or never used force against whom? Any of his wives or what? The slaves. And in fact, he dealt with them despite all the problems and the jealousy with the best wisdom, with the best what? Kindness. We are told the third reason why divorce cases is on the rise in many communities is due to what? Lack of compatibility. And please focus on this point. What do we mean when people are not compatible? We don't necessarily mean that they love the same color, or they like the same car, or they love the same type of movies. No. In the religion of Islam, compatibility is in reference to what? Is in reference to the principles and the values that shape up a marriage. What is that? Let me give you an example from the life, the illustrious life of Amir al-Mu'mineen and Sayyidatul Nisa, Fatima al-Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. That what do we find? We find that a man comes to the Holy Prophet and says, Ya Rasulullah, I'm hungry, there's no food. The Prophet sends a message to his wives. Do you have any food? They say, no. Amir al-Mu'mineen stands and says, Ya Rasulullah, I will take him home. I will feed him. He takes this man a note. When he enters, he says to Sayyida that I have bought a poor person and I wish that we feed him. Sayyida knows that they do not have enough food for this person. They only have food for whom? For Hassan and Hussein. That's it. And Hassan and Hussein have not eaten. So when there is compatibility for the sake of Allah, everything fits together and they both work together to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what happens? Sayyida says, I will make Hassan and Hussein sleep and they're hungry. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen says, I will bring the food, I will switch off the candle because it's only sufficient for one person to eat. He would not see that I'm not eating with him because I want him to eat it all by himself. This man eats the food in darkness, does not see that Amir al-Mu'mineen is sitting there, not eating anything. The family of Amir al-Mu'mineen sleep hungry. That morning, next morning, the Prophet said, Ya Ali, Allah has revealed a verse in your merit. وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أنفسهم ولو كان بهم خصاصة. Chapter 59, verse number 9. It says that they prefer others over themselves even though they needed it more. Can you imagine when there is compatibility that when both the husband and the wife say that our goal is to please Allah, our goal is to attain paradise. Let's work together to make sure that we, as well as our children, are those that attain Jannah on the Day of Judgment. Yes? If that is the goal, then what? They both work together. Because one of the scholars, one of the khutaba, he himself mentions, he says, one day I said, let the husband and the wife work together so that Allah raises them both in Jannah, in paradise together. He said, when I said this, one of the congregation, an elderly man, stood up, looked unhappy and left the hall. He went out. So I continued my majlis. When I finished, I saw him sitting outside. I went to him. I said, Ya Hajj, is everything okay? Did I say something wrong? He said, he looked at me and says, Ya Sheikh, how could you say this? He said, why? He said, all my life, I'm trying to get rid of my wife. You want her to come to Jannah with me? Can you imagine that type of thinking exists? Whereas Islam says no. Islam says that as far as marriage is concerned, the goal is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The compatibility is with regards to the principles and what and values. Number four is in reference to communication. So many times today, scholars, counselors, therapists, lawyers, attorneys, they get this particular request for divorce because there is a breakdown in communication between the husband and the wife. What do we mean? We mean that the male and the female have been created different by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That each of them have their what? Have their strengths and have their weaknesses. Each of them have their needs and have their wants. The way a male thinks is not the same as the way the female thinks and vice versa. Yes, females require attention, require compassion, require love. Males require respect and require obedience. If there is no understanding of the different setups as far as the gender on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned, if there is no concerted effort to listen, if there is no concerted effort to be careful not to use certain words when it comes to what heated exchanges between the husband and wife that causes the individual to be upset. You know, one of the words that should not be used between the husband and the wife is what? Divorce. Ban this word from the household. Do not allow it, because sometimes what people do, they use it as a tool. You know what, if you don't listen to me, I can divorce you. Yes? The idea exists is what? The idea is that communication plays such a vital role in ensuring a healthy marital setup. When the husband and the wife understand each other's needs, when they understand what makes each other upset, what each other expects and wants. That's why the Prophet of Islam says, when you say to your wife, I love you, this will never leave her heart. But it doesn't mean you say to her once only in your life, huh? Because one person said, I said to my wife, I love you 20 years ago, why should I repeat? Yes? The idea is not, it's that you should continuously express the love and the affinity. How? Exchange the gifts, not only on birthdays or necessarily anniversaries or at other times. Surprise each other with gifts. Show your love towards each other. Do not treat each other as enemies or adversaries. Treat each other the way you treat your best friend. And that has to be the psyche. Yes, reminding ourselves as to what the purpose should be, that we keep a strong family unit. For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for our own success, isn't it? We are told the other important element that causes divorce is the lack of patience, the lack of forgiveness. I recall that Prophet Nuh, ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi afdalu salatu wa salam, had what? A wife who the Quran condemns in chapter 66. No one can say that the wives of the prophets all have to be righteous, because the Quran says, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مْرَأَةَ نُوحٍ وَمْرَأَةَ لُوطٍ. Allah gives a parable, a similitude to the disbelievers when it comes to the wife of Nuh and the wife of Lut. They came to Nuh in narrations. They said to him, Ya Nabi Allah, why is it that you are tolerant with your wife? Why don't you divorce her? Listen to his response. He says, if I can't be patient with my wife at my house, how can I be patient outside when dealing with all the other people? I have to display patience. I know that sometimes people go through hardship. People have peaks and troughs in their relationships. But a key element for a healthy relationship and avoiding divorce is the ability to withstand the challenges and exercise sabr, and at the same time forgive for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is of great importance. We today, unfortunately, let me be honest with you, sometimes today in the West, the idea of divorce is sold as something very, you know, normal over the simplest of things. Sometimes the wife leaves the house. Over the simplest of matters, sometimes the husband wants to leave his wife. Yes, perseverance, endurance, patience for the sake of Allah sometimes is missing from our marital setups. Yes, there is so much emphasis that you and I need to look at this particular area and ensure that we fulfill it. Number six of great importance, or number five, is what? Is high expectation. Allahu Akbar. This is where what the famous subject and the area of social media, as we mentioned, comes into play. That people often compare their situation with others. They look at what others have, and therefore they have these high demands as far as husband or wife is concerned. They place this burden upon the other. Look at the example of Amir al-Mu'mineen. We are told one day he came home and he saw Sayyidatul Nisa pale. He saw Imam al-Hasan and Hussein pale. Yes, it is likely that he was not there for the last few days, because either he was somewhere fighting for the sake of Allah or fulfilling a responsibility. He said to them, what has happened? Yes, they say, we have not eaten for 3 days. He says, why is it that you did not tell me or sent me a message or informed me? Look at the response of Sayyidatul Nisa. We are followers of Fatima al-Zahra. It's not for you and I, for me, just to listen to a story, say magnificent, beautiful, but not apply it to our lives. Sayyidatul Nisa says what? My father taught me never to burden my husband with anything that I know he cannot provide. Come on, come on. She knew that Amir al-Mu'mineen was not able to provide the food. Yet she would not place this expectation upon the commander of the faithful. Today, as husband and wife is concerned, we have to show loyalty. We have to show strength in character as far as resisting the temptations. Today we have the iPhone and the iPad and the iMac, and everyone wants the I want. Yes, everyone wants everything. We live in a materialistic driven society. People are obsessed with what? Having and accumulating. Let's be careful not to fall into the traps, because these are indeed vital to keep a marital relationship healthy and indeed quite strong. What do we find? The other reason why sometimes people end their marital relationship is when they do not understand Sharia law as far as what is wajib for the husband and the wife to do. In other words, the roles and the responsibilities are not clear in the minds of many people. For instance, we are told it is the right of the wife upon her husband that he provides for her, that he fulfills what? The need for an accommodation, the need for food, the need for shelter and clothing. These must be provided. It is surprising and saddening today that I hear, yes, here in the United States, stories in which the husbands come and say to their wives, you know what, you should be working, I'm not bothered. Or they give excuses so that they stay at home and they send their wives in the workplace because they do not want to provide for the family. Providing for the family is wajib, is one of the responsibilities of the husband. They cannot forsake this particular responsibility. If the wife is the richest woman on this earth, she is not obliged in Islam to give a single cent when it comes to this particular setup. Yes, it's highly recommended to help the husband, but if she doesn't, then it's not necessary for what? For her to do so. Likewise, what do we find? We find it is a responsibility as far as the husband is concerned, not to mistreat his wife, to be able to provide her with this love, with this environment of warmth. And at the same time, for the woman, for the wives to understand the responsibility that we entail, we discussed earlier, as far as the sexual rights of the husband, that whenever the husband wants to have sexual intimacy, the wife must say yes. Yes, it is not an option out there, except that if she is going through a medical reason or a religious reason. Other than that, what? It is the right of the husband, as stipulated in the teachings of Sharia law. Likewise, with regards to what? With regards to her leaving. But when I say this, it doesn't mean people should stick to this word by word and letter by letter. Let me explain this very quickly. It doesn't mean that what? That if the husband does not allow the wife to leave, then the wife would say and come and demand from the husband payment for the breastfeeding or for the cooking, because she doesn't have to cook, she doesn't have to clean. These are what? They are there for what? For there to be a barometer. But for a marriage to last, it should be much more involving ethical respect and akhlaqi conduct between the husband and wife. It should not be tit for tat. If you don't give me this, I don't give you that. Because some of the people have memorized this part of Masail, of the book of the fatawas of our maraji. They say, you know, my right is this. If you don't do this, then I don't do this. This marriage is bound to fail. Is bound to fail. Whereas we should do what? We should know that this is something that we should not transgress. But more than that, work hard to ensure that what? We keep as much as possible the ethical standards alive. Another factor for the divorce rates rises is infidelity. Meaning what? Meaning that the husbands in their marital setups, they choose to go have a relationship, either sometimes legal, Islamically legal, for instance, like a second marriage, either permanent or temporary, or sometimes, God forbid, illegal. Now, sometimes our sisters, they come forward and say, how do we make sure that this doesn't necessarily happen? Well, there is one option. As far as those who are not married are concerned, they can have a prenuptial. They can stipulate that what for they must make sure that the particular stipulation is worded that they do not want their husbands to marry when they're alive, as long as they are alive, for their husbands not to marry another wife. And if they do, then they have the wakala to perform the talaq, in order to ask for the talaq and to get it from the hakim al-shar'i, from the jurist, from the ruler, or from the Islamic jurist. We are told that this particular element is causing problems. And I say this, based on the cases that we receive out there, that it is so difficult. And I know there are exceptional cases sometimes, but we are talking generally. It is very difficult for the female to accept this, especially in the West, that the husband seek another wife or has another relationship, because the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the female, she wants the husband just for herself. Another reason that we are told is cited is family interference. Some of our brothers, they complain. They say, our wives, the first thing that she does every morning is gives a full report to the mother. What exactly happened in the house? Yes? Every day, all the asrar, all the secrets are given away. This is hugely problematic that we are told. And I give you this. In a gathering with Ayatollah al-Uzma, Sayyid Ali Sistani, Hafidhahullah, private gathering. We were sitting with him and I heard this from him directly. He said one of the reasons why divorces are happening, especially in the West, he said, get this message across. It's because too many times secrets are being told to others, which causes jealousy, which causes hatred, fragmentation, separation, the husband and wife looking at others, imagining other things. When people disclose matters which are only supposed to be kept within the four walls of the house. This is very, very important. That when it comes to the husband and wife, they have to have an agreement. These issues must not be disclosed only by the permission of the husband. When it comes to the family, they have an important role. Yes, they can mediate, but only when the husband and wife are not able to resolve their differences. The differences should be resolved first and foremost by themselves. Today we have too much interference sometimes from both sides, because what happens when they complain to them? They naturally sometimes take sides. They take one side over the other. And that's why we are told that when it comes to families, yes, they have an important role, but they must act with justice and adala. If there is a problem, irrespective if this problem is from the man or from the woman, they should take the side of the haq, but not to fuel and place more hatred, but with the intention to bring them closer together. Can you imagine if the wife complains to the mother, my husband, he stays up late, he does not come back. The mother should say what to her daughter? The wrong answer is, I can't believe you're standing this. How could you be tolerating this? That's the wrong answer. That's fueling her more. The right answer is, my daughter, don't worry. Be patient, treat him nicely. In a nice conversation, mention this, ask him. Yes, provide this love and compassion to him. Because the objective should be for the parents, for the marriage to what? For the marriage to last and to be strong and to be a model in society as the Ahlul Bayt wanted it. Not that because, my son or my daughter's complaining. How dare their husband or their wife treat them in this way? The husband, the father and the mother from both sides should be the champions of keeping the marriage strong and healthy. Very important role they play. And finally, the 10th reason why today we are told divorces happen is because of financial burdens. Burdens that sometimes people go through. They are unable to, for instance, work. They are unable to provide for their family. And that's why loyalty at difficult times is one of the most important characteristics for both the husband and the wife. Because not all of us go through rosy times all the time. We go through difficult difficult times. Sometimes we go through hardship. Sometimes we go through situations in which we would like to avoid, but we cannot help it. That's where the husband and wife stand to support each other, to ensure that they both are able to leave this difficult life or time in their lives and build together, in order for this family unit to be sacred, in order for the family unit to look at examples of families that were there on the 10th of Muharram. Because truly, when you and I analyze the epic of Karbala and the tragedy of Ashura, there are so many dimensions, and one of them is with regards to family life. How Sayyid al-Shuhada ensured that this university has so many areas for people to learn and apply. And indeed, by ensuring a family life is protected and preserved, we make sure that the children rise in the healthiest of ways, both spiritually and physically, looking at examples of the children that stood with Aba Abdullah to sacrifice their lives on the 10th of Muharram. And one of those was the son of Al-Hasan al-Mujtaba by the name of Qasim. Yes, this wonderful young man, Qasim, who according to the narrations was 12 or 13 years of age, this particular young man who would accompany Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, who would stand on the night of Ashura, would listen to the sermon and the direction of Aba Abdullah, would then come and speak to his uncle. His uncle would say to him, "Oh Qasim, how is death in your eyes?" Qasim would respond, would say, "Oh my master Aba Abdullah, it's sweeter than honey." Yes, that Qasim saw in Imam al-Hussein a man who is truly saving the religion of Islam. Therefore, even though he was young, even though he never had a chance to enjoy his life, he would want to sacrifice himself for the sake of the religion of Islam. That's why on the 10th of Muharram, when he heard his uncle cry out, "Ala hal min nasirin yansuruna, ala hal min mughithin yughithuna," is there anyone who will help us? Is there anyone who will assist us? And the narrations tell us that Qasim came to Imam al-Hussein saying to him, "Oh my uncle, allow me to go to the battlefield. Allow me to fight. I cannot bear hearing you calling for assistance and no one supporting you." Imam al-Hussein would look at him. He would say, "Bunay Qasim, anta wadi'atu akhi al-Hasan. You are the son of my brother Hassan. I cannot see you go to the battlefield and killed in this way. Go back." Notice Qasim was so upset. His heart was pumping in anticipation to fight. But now he returns back to the tent. He looks at his mother. "Oh mother, I do not have permission to fight in the battlefield." His mother Ramla would come out. She would say, "Take this letter, show it to Aba Abdullah." Qasim takes the letter. Yes, she goes to Imam al-Hussein. Imam takes the letter, opens it. It's the letter from Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba. It says, "My brother Aba Abdullah, I am not there on the 10th of Muharram to help you. I am unable to assist you in person. But please accept my son Qasim as a sacrifice on my behalf. Allow him to fight in the battlefield." Imam al-Hussein weeps and cries. They hug. He hugs al-Qasim. He says, "If you are about to go, then go and get ready and bid farewell to the women of the Ahl al-Bayt." Qasim returns back to the tent. He goes to a box that was preserved. It has the aba of his father. It has the amama, the turban of his father. It has the sword of his father. He puts all this on. He stands to bid farewell to Sayyida Zainab, to his mother. When he looks at them, they all weep and cry. They say, "It is as if we see Hassan al-Mujtaba before us." This is so difficult for the mothers when they bid farewell to a young man who is only 12 or 13. The narrations tells us that he charged towards the battlefield. Humayd ibn Muslim says, a young man whose face was like an illuminating moon. He came towards us so courageous, so brave, wanting to fight. On his right hand, he had the sword, and he was walking towards us. He was fighting in the way that he wanted to, until what happened? All of a sudden, one of his sandals, Humayd says, especially the one on the left, the straps were broken. Ajarakum Allah. Qasim bends down. He wants to fix his sandals. A man comes and says, I will make his father and his mother mourn for him. Humayd says, is it not enough that he is surrounded by so many? This man says, no. He picks up a sword. He strikes it on the head of Qasim. The narration says the sword was so heavy, the head of Qasim splits. Qasim falls onto the ground. Amma Hussein, adrikni, he says. Oh my uncle Hussein, come towards me, help me, oh Hussein. Imam al-Hussein hears this cries of al-Qasim, rushes towards him, Allahu Akbar, sits next to him. He says, my nephew Qasim, it is so difficult for your uncle to hear your cries, but not able to assist you, but come next to you and not able to save you. Allahu Akbar. The narrations tell us that the soul of Qasim leaves this world. Imam al-Hussein wants to carry the body of Qasim. He picks up the body. Some who saw him saw that he was dragging the body. His back was nailed down, that the feet were dragging. Why? He was under so much pain to see this young man being treated in this way. He brings the body of Qasim, places him next to the body of Ali ibn al-Akbar. On one side, he looks at Ali ibn al-Akbar's body torn into pieces. On the other, he looks at Qasim and his head split into two. At that moment, Sayyida Zainab, what does she do? She says, oh, my brother Hussein, the mother of Qasim wants to mourn him. The mother of Qasim wants to cry for him. I tell you, what was the mother of Qasim thinking to see when she entered the tent? Imam said, let the women come, let them mourn. They entered the tent and saw the bodies of Ali ibn al-Akbar and Qasim in such a way, they threw themselves on their bodies. They began to cry, wa Qasima, wa mazluma, wa shahida. ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين وإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون